The subcommittee will come to order. The chairman notes the presence of a quorum, which under committee rule 3E is two members. And we have doubled that. And hopefully we'll have more to join us. The subcommittee on Fisheries, Wildlife, Oceans, and Insular Affairs is meeting today to hear testimony on H.R. 2706, the Bill Fish Conservation Act of 2011, H.R. 3472, the Pirate Fishing Vessel Disposal Act of 2011, and H.R. 4100, the Illegal, Unreported, and Unregulated Fishing Enforcement Act of 2011. Under Committee Rule 4F, opening statements are limited to the chairman and ranking member of the subcommittee so that we can hear from our witnesses more quickly. However, I ask unanimous consent to include any other members' opening statements in the hearing record if submitted to the clerk by close of business today. In addition, since two of our subcommittee members are the authors of two of the bills being heard, I ask unanimous consent to allow them to each make a statement in support of their bill. Hearing no objection, so ordered. Today we will hear testimony on three pieces of legislation: H.R. 2706, the Bill Fish Conservation Act of 2011, H.R. 3472, the Pirate Fishing Vessel Disposal Act of 2011, and H.R. 4100, the Illegal, Unreported, and Unregulated Fishing Enforcement Act of 2011. Two of these bills deal with illegal, unreported, and unregulated fishing practices, also known as IUU fishing. IUU fishing adversely affects legitimate fishermen from around the world by overfishing, fishing in illegal areas, using illegal gear, and adversely affecting important habitat. IUU fishing practices have long-term impacts on fish stocks and on the reproductive viability of many commercially important fisheries. While many nations are now paying more attention to this problem, stateless vessels or vessels flying a flag of convenience fishing on the high seas continue to be a problem. This legislation would amend 9 statutes to provide for penalties against those caught engaged in IUU fishing. To highlight this concern, as recently as last September, a stateless fishing vessel was seized by the U.S. Coast Guard in international waters more than 2,500 miles southwest of Kodiak, Alaska. The vessel had more than 30 tons of squid and 54 shark carcasses on board at the time it was seized. While the capture of this vessel is the good news, the vessel turned out to be infested with rats, which raise concerns about how, where, and when to bring the vessel into a U.S. port for prosecution. Once that issue was dealt with, it took until June of this year to determine what to do with the vessel. The second bill for discussion today would allow the Coast Guard to use such vessels for live fire sinking exercises if other options, such as using the vessel for educational purposes, are not appropriate. While this option would be one of the several options available for the Coast Guard, it would guarantee that the vessel could never return to fishing and could not ever be used for IUU fishing again. I'm curious to hear from our witnesses today on this legislation. The third bill deals with the harvest and the sale of billfish, including a number of species of marlins and spearfish. The legislation would make it illegal to sell billfish or billfish products in the continental U.S. Under current law, it is illegal to sell Atlantic billfish, but the rules for the harvest and sale of billfish in the Pacific are different. Concern has been raised that this situation allows the black market sale of Atlantic billfish, which is mislabeled at Pacific caught billfish, as Pacific caught billfish. As I understand it, the primary target of this legislation is foreign commercial fishing vessels. However, some concern has been raised that the legislation might disadvantage Hawaiian fishermen and fishermen from the U.S. insular areas who might lose access to markets in the continental U.S. if this legislation were to become law. We will hopefully examine the concern here today with our witnesses. I also understand similar legislation moving in the Senate may have been modified to address this concern. However, I would like to continue to work with the bill sponsor to address this concern so that the legislation controls the illegal sale of billfish but does not disadvantage U.S. fishermen. I look forward to hearing from our witnesses and now recognize the ranking member for 5 minutes for any statement he may have.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and I'd also like to welcome all our witnesses and our guests this afternoon. I also want to thank Ms. Bordaglio for introducing one of the bills before us today, for which I'm an original co-sponsor, the Illegal, Unreported, and Unregulated, the IUU Fishing Enforcement Act of 2011. H.R. 4100 serves two critical purposes. It protects the environment and our economy. The United States demonstrates strong leadership in fisheries management, both nationally and internationally. Scientifically supported management standards are critical to the sustainability of our fisheries and therefore the livelihoods of our fishermen. U.S. fishermen have worked hard to meet the standards set forth in the Magnuson-Stevens Act. They have changed their gears, reduced bycatch, and met their catch limits. Their efforts are paying off as we are seeing the rebuilding of critical stocks around the nation. However, despite these efforts, over 80% of global marine fish stocks are exploited or depleted, which is driven in large part by the persistence of IUU fishing. With an annual global value of over $10 billion, IUU fishing undermines the United States fisheries management efforts and its fishermen who are forced to compete for the same fish with people who don't play by the same rules. Unsustainable fishing practices by foreign fishing fleets adversely affect stocks that migrate between the U.S. Exclusive Economic Zone, the EEZ, and the high seas. In an area like the Pacific Islands region, which has an EEZ larger than that of the continental United States and Alaska combined, combating IUU fishing is particularly difficult. Near the Commonwealth of the Northern Marianas, the United States Coast Guard is on the front line in the fight against IUU fishing in the Pacific Ocean, helping to protect pelagic fish species in the U.S. EEZ. By promoting stability in Pacific fisheries, the Coast Guard protects our fishermen and helps to build better relations throughout the Pacific region. Fishing is not only a critical component of our culture and livelihood in the Northern Mariana Islands, but it's an essential source of food for the Marianas people and many of our neighboring Pacific Island nations. Through collaborative work, the Coast Guard is able to share intelligence and best practices, thereby improving the international monitoring of IUU. While this is a good start, actually it's a very good start, the Coast Guard needs more resources and enforcement capabilities to effectively combat IUU fishing. In 2009, a vessel was seized outside of Saipan with 10 tons of illegally caught sharks on board. The Coast Guard had observed the vessel illegally fishing in the U.S. EEZ, and the boat owner was fined $500,000, only $200,000 of which he had been required to pay so far. The case was settled, and the crew members were not arrested, but were released with their boat. We need to ensure that NOAA and the Coast Guard have the tools to monitor and track IUU fishing, the effectiveness of enforcement actions against IUU crimes. IUU fishermen are free riders who benefit unfairly from the sacrifices made by U.S. fishermen, and H.R. 4100 would provide the additional tools critically needed to help the NOAA and the U.S. Coast Guard more effectively fight against IUU fishing. This bill will strengthen and improve the enforcement authorities and align them under the Magnuson-Stevens Act with more stringent penalties. It would also provide additional abilities for the United States to identify and penalize nations that do not comply with the Regional Fisheries Management Organization recommendations that U.S. fishermen so diligently follow. These are just a few of the benefits prescribed in this important legislation we will discuss today. I'm also interested to hear from our witnesses regarding H.R. 2706, the Billfish Conservation Act of 2011, and H.R. 3472, the Pirate Vessel Disposal Act of 2011. I thank each of our witnesses for joining us today and look forward to hearing from you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Gentleman yields back, the ranking member. Next, I recognize Ms. Bordaglio, the author of H.R. 4100, the Illegal, Unreported, and Unregulated Fishing Enforcement Act of 2011, for 5 minutes in support of her legislation.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and Ranking Member, for holding a hearing on this important legislation to aid our nation's fisheries. Illegal fishing threatens the economic and social infrastructure of fishing communities around the world by decreasing opportunities for legitimate and conscientious fishermen. I introduced the Illegal, Unreported, and Unregulated Fishing Enforcement Act to protect the United States fisheries from the free riders who benefit unfairly from the sacrifices made by our fishermen for the sake of proper fisheries, conservation, and management. Guam and the Commonwealth of the Northern Marianas and the other Western Pacific territories host rich fisheries resources, including pristine reefs, diverse communities of reef fish, and a large population of sharks and valuable tuna, important economic and cultural assets for the islands. IUU fishing threatens these resources. Just this spring, Chinese fishermen were found illegally fishing along reefs in Palau, creating a significant international incident. There have been several other incidents of foreign fishing vessels operating within the United States EEZ with impunity, and that are significant national security and economic risks to our country. This bill takes a number of important steps towards strengthening Coast Guard and NOAA enforcement mechanisms to identify and penalize these pirate fishermen. Our system for managing fisheries, such as the regional fisheries management consuls, is undermined by illegal operators. In Guam, the Coast Guard does not have the resources to effectively manage the vast marine territory. The United States Pacific lands represent 43% of the EEZ. Our focus should be on the posture of our Coast Guard in the Asia-Pacific region. So this bill will help to provide our Coast Guard with the tools to better enforce regulations throughout the sector, but is only part of the solution. Further actions are necessary to strengthen our nation's response to pirate fishing. My bill increases capacity for inspection, identification, and monitoring of illegal foreign vessels, amends several international agreements to incorporate civil and criminal penalties, and also broadens data sharing authority with foreign governments in order to identify and penalize nations that do not comply with fisheries management regulations. Increased enforcement also increases stability among our allies in the Western Pacific. Many nations depend on fishing as a vital component of their national economy. In fact, in Nauru, the island's police force explained that overfishing and depleted fish stocks would cause tremendous hardship for their island nation. As we refocus on the Asia-Pacific region, we cannot ignore the needs of our allies. The loss of fishing resources because of illegal fishing increases the risk of economic and social collapse. The Coast Guard's presence in the region fortifies our standing in the region while deterring illegal activities. Fishing communities are the lifeblood of Guam, Sihanoukville, and other islands in the Pacific, part of a cultural history extending back centuries. So protecting our fishermen from illegal fishing enhances economic opportunities and protects cultural and natural resources that our communities rely upon. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for the opportunity to explain my bill.
Gentlelady yields back. We'd now like to hear from our witnesses, so if you would come forward and take your places. Okay. The chairman would like to introduce our panel. First up is Mr. Eric Schwab, Assistant Administrator of Fisheries, National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration. Great to see you back again, Mr. Schwab. Mr. Arnie Thompson, President of United Fishermen of Alaska. Dr. John Graves, Chair, ICAT Advisory Committee. And Mr. Jason Schratweiser. Did I pronounce that correctly? Conservation Director, International Game Fish Association. Like all our witnesses, your written testimony will appear in full in the hearing record. So I ask that you keep your oral statement to 5 minutes as outlined in our invitation letter to you and under Committee Rule 4A. Our microphones are not automatic, so please press the button when you're ready to begin and make sure the tip of the mic is close enough to you that we can hear you. I also want to explain how our timing lights work. Very simply, you have 5 minutes. You'll be under green light for four, then yellow light for the last minute, and when it turns red, please conclude your statement. So first up is Mr. Schwab. You have 5 minutes, sir.
Thank you. Good afternoon, Chairman Fleming, Ranking Member Sablon, other members of the subcommittee. My name is Eric Schwab, and I am the NOAA Assistant Administrator for Fisheries, also currently overseeing the Office of Conservation and Management within NOAA. Thank you very much for the opportunity to testify today on legislation dealing with IUU fishing, pirate fishing disposal, and billfish conservation. I will address these topics in that order. First, some general words about the impacts of IUU fishing. IUU fishing harms both fish and fishermen. It undermines the conservation and management measures, such as quotas or bycatch limits, which have been established for domestic fisheries or under international agreements. IUU fishing also harms the legitimate fishermen who play by the rules and whose catch must compete against the illegal harvest in the marketplace. Annual global economic losses due to IUU fishing are estimated to be between $10 and $23 billion. This impact is felt throughout the world, including by our fishermen here in the U.S. IUU fishing hurts the profitability of the U.S. seafood industry by introducing cheaper fish into the marketplace. U.S. fishermen participate in some of the most sustainably managed fisheries in the world. The management measures needed to achieve this have required sacrifices by our fishermen. It is only fair for them to be free from competing with seafood caught illegally. In 2010, U.S. consumers spent an estimated $80.2 billion for fishery products. In producing and marketing these items, the commercial fishing industry contributed over $41 billion in value to the U.S. gross national product. Simply put, IUU fishing risks the sustainability of this multi-billion dollar domestic U.S. industry. As one of the world's largest importers and consumers of seafood, the U.S. is in a strong position to support sustainable fisheries around the world while providing a level playing field for our domestic fishermen. To achieve this, it is imperative that we take steps to eliminate the economic incentives associated with IUU fishing. Currently, we have a few tools in our toolbox for combating such fishing. I'd like to share a particularly interesting case to help illustrate the work we do with other federal partners to support our domestic fishermen. In this case in the Gulf of Mexico, a number of individuals and companies were prosecuted for criminal offenses related to a large-scale seafood smuggling scheme. The defendants conspired to illegally import and sell fraudulently labeled Vietnamese catfish as grouper or other more valuable species. They did this to avoid federal import tariffs associated with Vietnamese catfish, which would have been in this case approximately $9.3 million. They also did this because the market value of grouper is much higher, generally more than double that of Vietnamese catfish. The defendants illegally imported more than 10 million pounds of frozen fish fillets. These types of illegal activities threaten to displace legitimate, legally produced domestic fish and create an uneven playing field for U.S. fishermen. This is not something that we work on alone. We work closely with partner agencies relying on the U.S. Coast Guard to develop policy and conduct operations across multiple ocean basins. Often these threats exist on high seas and in remote areas. And given the highly migratory nature of some fish stocks, protected living marine resources and sharks, it is also critical that we work cooperatively with international partners to implement fishery management programs. Specifically regarding H.R. 4100, NOAA strongly supports the intent of this legislation to provide additional tools to combat IUU fishing. Among other things, The legislation makes several significant changes to improve current international fisheries statutes, advances enforcement capabilities, and authorizes a broader capacity building program to help other nations address IUU fishing on their own. Regarding the Pirate Fishing Vessel Disposal Act of 2011, we have not taken a position on this act, but we would be happy to provide a formal views letter at a later date. It is clear, however, that treatment of seized vessels is of great importance to NOAA, the Coast Guard, and other agencies, and we look forward to working with this committee and the bill's sponsor on this important issue. Finally, with respect to the Billfish Conservation Act, the administration, again, has not taken a specific position on the act, but we certainly recognize the conservation challenges facing billfish populations in the Atlantic Ocean and to a lesser extent in the Pacific. Current regulations include a broad federal prohibition on commercial possession, landing, and sale of billfish in the Atlantic, and some limiting controls on the West Coast. The implications of this bill are somewhat limited in the Pacific Islands region, given the current language that does not include swordfish in the definition and also allows sales of defined billfish in Hawaii and the Pacific Island territories. We would love to work with the committee in more detail on some of these exemptions for clarification purposes. Mr. Fleming, thank you again for the opportunity to be here, and I look forward to your questions.
Thank you, Mr. Schwab. Next up, Mr. Thompson, 5 minutes, sir.
I'm president of the United Fishermen of Alaska, executive director of the Alaska Crab Coalition. The Alaska Bering Sea Crabbers, the Intercooperative Exchange, the Fishing Vessel Owners Association, and the Crab Group of Independent Harvesters also endorse this statement. On behalf of these organizations, I thank the subcommittee for the opportunity to provide testimony on measures aimed against IUU fishing. Our organizations strongly support efforts to address IUU fishing. As I stated in a Senate meeting in December of last year, our organizations urged prompt ratification and legislative implementation of the Agreement on Port State Measures to Prevent, Deter, and Eliminate IUU Fishing. It is important to recognize, however, that in view of the nature and extent of the IUU problem, legislation beyond that, implementing the agreement is necessary. Based on our preliminary review of Mr. Young's bill, H.R. 3472, the Pirate Fishing Vessel Disposal Act of 2011, and Representative Bordalo's bill, H.R. 4100, the IUU Fishing and Enforcement Act of 2011, we are confident that Congress will craft wise measures to address this complex and highly technical area. Today, I confine my statements to the reasons why legislative action is needed, and with your permission, request to submit for the record specific comments on these two proposals. Our organizations have been deeply involved in efforts to assess the impact of IUU fishing and to encourage a strong U.S. domestic and international response. Our organizations also deeply appreciate the dedication and leadership of members of Congress in addressing the challenges posed by IUU fishing. We are also grateful to Undersecretary Lubchenco for heading up the administration's successful initiative to conclude the new agreement to achieve ratification and implementation by the United States and broad acceptance by the key members of the international community. Dr. Lubchenco has rightly observed, and I quote, "Illegal, unreported, unregulated fishing is one of the most serious threats to American fishing jobs and fishing community, as well as to the health of the world's oceans," quote unquote. NOAA has declared that the United States is a global leader in sustainable fisheries management, and as the third largest importer of seafood, has a responsibility to ensure that what enters our commerce has been caught legally. NOAA has recognized that the United States has a responsibility to protect the American fishing industry from unfair competition and to ensure consumer confidence in this seafood supply by keeping IUU fish out of the market. UFA and the other organizations also wish to commend the ongoing domestic and international efforts to combat IUU fishing, as noted today in the statement of Mr. Eric Schwab, the Assistant Administrator for NOAA. Exhaustive research and close analysis have revealed the enormity of the damage to fishery resources, legal fishing businesses, and fishing communities caused by IUU fishing. Fisheries managers cannot achieve sustainable levels of fishing when IUU activities render accounting for catch levels impossible. Legal fishing businesses suffer and fishing communities suffer with them when legal fishing is curtailed in response to resource depletion that almost always eventuates from IUU fishing, and when market prices are depressed at home and abroad by enormous influxes of illegal product. The scale of IUU fishing impacts worldwide is reflected by the estimated annual production between 11 and 26 million tons and a value of $10 to $23 billion, as noted in Mr. Schwab's statement. According to the highly respected McDowell Group that has conducted extensive research reported to the Alaska Seafood Marketing Institute, IUU crab fishing is prevalent in Russia, although recent Russian enforcement efforts have had some effect. Mr. Jake Jacobson, a recognized expert in this field, has pointed out that from 2000 to 2010, 2.6 crab were illegally taken for every single crab legally harvested. In three of the last 10 years, the amount of Russian origin king crab imported into the US, Japan, and Korea far exceeded the entire total allowable Russian catch. In 2010, the estimated Russian illegal snow and king crab harvest of 39,370 metric tons was only slightly below the reported legal harvest of 39,576 metric tons for a total of 78,900 metric tons total harvest. In that year, Russian IUU crab production was greater than the entire Alaska production, and since 2005 has been up to five times larger, according to McDowell. I'll end my remarks there, Mr. Chairman, and thank you again for the opportunity to testify before the Resources Committee. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Thompson. And next up is Dr. Graves. You have 5 minutes, sir.
Good afternoon, Mr. Chairman and members of the subcommittee. My name is John Graves, and I'm a professor of marine science at the Virginia Institute of Marine Science, College of William & Mary. For the past 17 years, I have chaired the U.S. ICAT Advisory Committee. I am grateful for the opportunity to comment on the bills before you today. Recognizing the depleted status of Atlantic billfish stocks and the economic value of the recreational billfish fishery, the United States prohibits the retention of Atlantic billfishes on commercial vessels, as well as the sale or importation of Atlantic billfishes. Several billfish stocks in the Pacific and Indian Oceans are overfished, and the United States is a major importer of Indo-Pacific billfishes. Should our markets provide an economic incentive for those harvests? I don't think so. H.R. 2706 would essentially close our markets to these products, and that could benefit the resource. I strongly support efforts to reduce fishing mortality on overfished stocks of Indo-Pacific billfishes. Fisheries around the world are overcapitalized. Simply put, there's more than enough capacity to harvest the available fish. Effective fisheries management requires mechanisms to maintain fleet capacities consistent with sustainable harvest. H.R. 3472 provides a mechanism for ensuring that those vessels that have been forfeited for engaging in IUU fishing do not return to any fishery. I strongly support measures to eradicate IUU fishing capacity. IUU fishing is a serious problem globally, and it is a problem within ICAT. Almost every stock managed by ICAT faces challenges from IUU fishing. These include lack of data reporting, late reporting of data, misreporting of data, quota overages, catches of fish below the minimum size, violations of time area closures, the use of unauthorized gears, and failures to implement conservation and management measures. As I reported to this subcommittee 3 years ago, ICAT adopted several measures to combat various components of IUU fishing. Since that time, the Commission has continued to make progress to eliminate IUU fishing, improving the IUU vessel list and the bluefin catch document, implementing a pilot electronic bluefin catch document system, increasing observer coverage in certain fisheries, increasing penalties for non-reporting of landings, and requiring transparency of access agreements. Developing international consensus of IUU management measures at ICAT is a challenging process, but it is ultimately dependent upon the resolve of member nations to implement and enforce those measures. An external review in 2008 noted that ICAT as a tuna RFMO has a sound base. It has done many things well and continues to do so, but it has failed against its objective because its contracting parties have failed in their responsibilities. Fortunately, over the past 4 years, under the leadership of Dr. Christopher Rogers as chair of the Compliance Committee, there have been major changes in the committee's operation. There is now a transparent process in which the performance of all parties is carefully and systematically reviewed, and penalties for compliance lapses can include multilateral trade sanctions. It is heartening to see multilateral resolve to eliminate IUU fishing. But these problems are not always addressed by regional fishery management organizations in a sufficiently timely or effective manner. More help is needed. The Magnuson-Stevens Act was a big step in the right direction, providing unilateral tools to combat IUU fishing. The changes contained in H.R. 4100 further that cause. At ICAT, catch data for 1 year are reported late the following year, and these numbers can be adjusted in subsequent years, and not all parties report on time. We cannot allow late reporting of data to be a means to avoid compliance. I strongly support providing a lengthened time period to determine an IUU listing under the MRSA. Further, providing NOAA clear authority to identify nations for violation of RFMO measures, such as the lack of data reporting, could also help address IUU activities. As a major fish importing nation, it is our responsibility to ensure that we do not promote IUU fishing through our markets. H.R. 4100 makes progress in this regard, providing new and improved tools to combat IUU fishing. I am very supportive of the bill. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Graves. Finally, Mr. Schrettweiser, you have 5 minutes, sir.
Good afternoon, Chairman Fleming, Ranking Member Sablon, and members of the subcommittee. Thank you for inviting me here today to speak about H.R. 2706, the Billfish Conservation Act of 2011, and how the United States can take a leadership role in improving their conservation for the benefit of U.S. fishermen and the U.S. economy. My name is Jason Schrettweiser, and I'm the Conservation Director for the International Game Fish Association. The IGFA is a nonprofit organization founded in 1939 that represents recreational anglers throughout the world. IGFA has active members in over 100 countries and is a governing body for international recreational fishing. The core of our membership is thousands of offshore anglers who catch and release billfish and are very supportive of this bill. Marlin, sailfish, and spearfish, collectively termed billfish, are open ocean apex predators that can be, in many ways, be compared to lions, bears, and tigers on land. I would like to point out, as Mr. Schwab said before, that swordfish are not being considered in this bill and are being managed better in some areas. Like their terrestrial counterparts, billfish are far less abundant than the prey species they feed on, and they play a critical role in keeping the natural balance in the respective ecosystems. Besides having an important ecological role in the wild, billfish support vibrant recreational catch and release fisheries that yield significant economic benefits, both in the United States and abroad. A study published in 2003 found that U.S. billfish anglers spend more than many other anglers. Direct and indirect expenditures from billfishing total more than $204 million annually for the Atlantic seaboard alone. On the east coast of the U.S., the National Marine Fisheries Service issued permits for more than 175 tournaments in 2011. These tournaments bring in millions through local economies, through hotel and restaurant sales and taxes, fishing charters, registration fees, fuel sales, and tourist attractions. Though billfish are typically not a target species in most commercial fisheries, they are frequently caught as bycatch and longline and purse seine gear intended for tuna and swordfish. The United States carefully regulates billfish harvest in its domestic fisheries and has prohibited the commercial harvest and sale of Atlantic billfish for over two decades. Most billfish caught by recreational anglers are released, and the entire Atlantic recreational fishery is limited to 250 marlin each year. Commercial anglers are also prohibited from possessing striped marlin on the west coast of the continental U.S. In the Pacific, U.S. commercial fisheries harvest billfish in Hawaii and adjacent island territories. Here, billfish are managed through the Western Pacific Fisheries Management Council, according to the standards set by the Magnuson-Stevens Fishery Conservation and Management Act. Unfortunately, billfish are not being managed well, if at all, elsewhere. In 2011, the International Union for the Conservation of Nature published the first ever global assessment of all billfish species. The report found that blue and white marlin met the criteria to list them as vulnerable to extinction, and striped marlin were considered to be near threatened with extinction. I want to emphasize that billfish are a highly migratory species. IGFA tagging initiatives have shown that they are capable of traveling over 4,700 miles in just 120 days. This means the billfish that are being harvested and sold to the U.S. by foreign countries are, in essence, our fish, too. Even though the United States manages the domestic harvest of billfish reasonably well, we are still part of the global problem. In 2007, the IGFA commissioned a study to evaluate international billfish harvest and trade. The results of this study found the United States is the world's largest importer of billfish. The top five biggest exporters to the United States by rank are Costa Rica, Ecuador, Vietnam, South Korea, and Philippines. According to our FDA, this totals some 1,335 metric tons annually, or approximately 30,000 fish. The excessive harvest of billfish from foreign countries, especially those in Central America, have very real negative impacts to not only our domestic fisheries, but for U.S. anglers who spend money on tackle and airfare to travel to fish for billfish in other countries. The IGFA report on billfish trade also found that the legal sale of Pacific-caught billfish creates a black market, which allows Atlantic-caught billfish to enter the United States. Thus, it is clear that importation from foreign countries is the problem, but it is something that cannot be fixed within our domestic fisheries management process. H.R. 2706 will ban the sale of billfish in the continental United States and would thus halt importation of billfish from foreign countries. This will eliminate a sizable market for exporting countries and will close the black market for Atlantic billfish. It will also strengthen the United States' position to enact better international measures to conserve billfish in the Pacific. The U.S. is a big player in Pacific regional fisheries management organizations that manage highly migratory species. Our delegations will be far better positioned to seek improved conservation in other nations when we are no longer importing more of these fish than other countries. We simply cannot hope to influence change in other countries till we create this change in our own. I would also like to speak to the consequences for U.S. consumers or commercial anglers. Studies have shown that seafood is a highly elastic commodity that is easily substituted for other goods. In general, billfish is a niche product here in the U.S., and much of it is sold in processed form, so that banning imports would merely cause consumers to shift to any number of readily available species of fish. The only U.S. commercial fishery for billfish occurs in Hawaii and adjacent Pacific insular areas. This bill carves out this region and would allow the continued harvest and sale of billfish within these areas. In summary, billfish populations are in decline globally. The highly migratory nature of these fish means that strong international conservation measures are critical to their survival. Passing H.R. 2706 would make the United States part of the solution by effectively ending the importation of billfish from foreign countries and strengthening the U.S. position to sanction enhanced protection for these nomadic fish. This would directly benefit U.S. recreational anglers who already spend considerable sums of money on boat, tackle, fuel, tournaments, and other goods, both here and abroad. Recreational fishing for billfish was started in the U.S. and is truly an American tradition. So is billfish conservation. The International Game Fish Association and its members strongly urge the passage of the Billfish Conservation Act of 2011. Thank you, committee.
Well, I thank the witnesses for their testimony, very valuable today. We'll begin questions in just a moment. Mr. Young, former chairman of Natural Resources, was on the floor speaking on another set of bills regarding this the full committee, but we're informed that he's on his way. We're going to give him the opportunity to speak on his bill, 3472, the Pirate Fishing Vessel Disposal Act of 2011, when he gets here. As a result, I'll go ahead and start off by yielding to myself for questions. Mr. Schwab, what is the primary market for the billfish?
Mr. Chairman, there are local markets for basically a whole fish product. There is also a processed market that can be characterized generally. They're often referred to as fish cakes. It's a processed product that is both consumed locally as well as exported, or transshipped to the mainland and exported to other places as well.
It's my understanding that certainly the United States is a large direct market, but it's also an indirect market. Can you give me an idea what is the proportion of, in terms of consumption, of billfish that the United States makes up at the present time?
Mr. Chairman, I am not aware that kind of data exists. There might be others on the panel that can provide some perspective on that.
Anyone else on the panel? It's my understanding it's a large portion. Am I correct in assuming that, or we don't really have any data on that? Obviously, the reason for asking the question is if we stop consumption in the United States, what is going to be the overall impact? And it'd be helpful to know in terms of that. But nonetheless, I appreciate your attempts at helping us with that. How much, I guess this is a little bit different way of looking at the question, how much that is exported, how much stays in the domestic market and how much is exported? Do we have that information at all?
So in 2010, approximately 784 metric tons of billfish, excluding swordfish, were landed in Hawaii and the Pacific U.S. territories. From 2006 to 10, the average was slightly over 1,000 metric tons. We don't really track billfish trade beyond landings, whether in local sales, transportation to the mainland, or in export to foreign countries. So there's not really a whole lot more other than those landings data that I can offer.
Okay. So it seems we really have poor data overall in terms of how it's fished, where it goes, how it's consumed, or where it's consumed. But it's my understanding that that the stocks appear low. We do have information of that.
Yes, sir. We do know that in the Atlantic blue marlin are considered to be overfished, and overfishing is occurring. White marlin suffered the same situation, overfished and undergoing overfishing. Western Atlantic sailfish are considered to be overfished but rebuilding. Atlantic round-scale spearfish is a species that looks similar to white marlin. We don't have any Atlantic data on status due to insufficient information. General consensus around the West Coast is that overfishing is occurring in the stock of striped marlin in the Northeast Pacific Ocean, but was not occurring. The results of the assessment indicated in the 2010 that overfishing of the stock of striped marlin in the Northeast Pacific Ocean was not occurring, and that the stock was not overfished. I could provide a little more data, but that's the general picture.
Okay, so obviously we're seeing some stress of the supply. Dr. Graves, there's some supporters of H.R. 2706 who argue that Atlantic billfish are entering the U.S. at a market labeled as Pacific billfish. Is this a serious conservation problem?
I don't believe so. It's an enforcement issue, but we've developed, for instance, you have blue marlin in the Atlantic and the Pacific, same species, but there are we've developed genetic techniques to differentiate those. So it's the techniques are there to identify where the animals are coming from, but there doesn't seem to be a big black market for them, no.
Okay. All right, thank you. Before yielding to the ranking member, I'd like to give Mr. Young an opportunity to speak on his bill for 5 minutes.
I thank you, the chairman. I do appreciate that. My bill is very simple, and it may sound strange to some people, but when we apprehend a vessel illegally fishing in our waters. Sometimes the vessel is at a dock and supported by, I believe, the United States maintained and kept afloat after they've been fishing illegally, and then sometimes they're sold to a entity that could possibly go back in the fishing or back to the owner originally. And my bill is very simple. If it is apprehended and it have been fishing illegally, just like a drug dealer or anyone else in the committing a crime, which it is a crime, and then the property is confiscated and destroyed or sold. Personally, I'd like to see the vessels that are caught fishing illegally in our waters. That goes all 200-mile limits, but primarily in Alaska, because that's where we have the most infringements, that, Mr. Chairman, that the ship be used for target practice by the Coast Guard. They need that. And it's a live object which they could shoot at after they make sure we take all the oil off of it, et cetera, et cetera. But sink it, and it leaves a great impression on those might thinking about being fishing illegally. So I'm suggesting in my bill, it's very simple. If the vessel's apprehended in our waters, fishing illegally, illegal caught on board, and is taken to port, and, of course, demand. I wouldn't say like the Russians did one time. I have to tell a story about that. We had a vessel we'd been chasing for a period of time, and they finally got to the donut hole, which is up in Alaska where there's nobody's water, and we notified the Russians, and it was a Chinese vessel, and we asked the Chinese all that time to heave to, and they didn't. The Russians took over. They asked them to heave to, and they didn't heave to, and they shot the wheelhouse off, and including the captain and a few other people, so the vessel was no longer operative. That's my kind of action. Of course, we don't do that. We don't do that. So I'm going to say that, though, in this case, I think it would send a message to those that want to fish illegally. Let's sink that vessel, put it out of commission so long, no longer. It's off offshore or cannot interfere. It's in waters a mile deep. And I think it helped the Coast Guard out. Well, with that, Mr. Chairman, I'll yield back the balance of my time.
Thank you, gentlemen, and former distinguished former chairman of the Natural Resources Committee. The chairman now recognizes Mr. Sablon, the ranking member, for 5 minutes.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. It's going to be rather hard to follow Mr. Young, but let me start this way. Mr. Schwab, it's always nice to see you. I think we got to stop meeting like this, sir, but thank you for joining us again. How do the provisions of H.R. 4100 compare to what is happening in other countries to combat IUU fishing?
Thank you, Mr. Sablon. I think that the fundamental difference generally in the way that we approach IUU fishing is in where the ability to sort of prove guilt or innocence resides. You know, the European Union and its 27 member states have implemented a system to deny imports of IUU caught fish, and that requires each incoming shipment to have documentation from the exporting state that the fish and fish products in the shipment were legally harvested. You know, in the U.S., we, I think, appropriately assume innocence until guilt is established. So our system requires that the Secretary of Commerce monitor worldwide fishing practices and where foreign vessels are conducting IUU fishing, identify that, and then use that as a basis to close or restrict imports of the relevant fish and fish products. That is the fundamental difference between, for example, the U.S. and the EU. One of the other big sets of import states.
So what additional tools would H.R. 4100 provide to allow the United States to, enforce internationally agreed upon fishing regulations? And how will this affect U.S. fishermen's bottom line?
So thank you. H.R. 4100 does a number of very important things to close some current gaps or to address some current challenges. It does, as we've heard already, extend the time frame for the identification of IUU vessels to 3 years to address some of the accounting challenges that the current time frame places upon us. It allows us to move from focusing only on the actions of individual vessels to take action based upon broader failures on the part of fishing nations. It allows the creation of an IUU vessel list specific to the U.S., which would be analogous, for example, and build upon some of the regional fishery management organization lists already in play. It improves our inspection capacity and our ability to share information. It also ratifies the Antigua Convention from the IATTC management area.
I'm going to ask a question here. I don't know if you have the answer, Mr. Swab, but besides the kayak and the Zodiac that they have, how many boats does the Coast Guard have in the, say, the Guam and the Marianas and Micronesia region to enforce?
I don't know the answer to that question. Yeah, I'm sorry.
I know they have a Zodiac and a kayak, and I think they have a boat out of Guam. But let me ask you, Mr. Thompson, good afternoon, sir. We're discussing legislation that would provide tools to help honest fishermen deliver sustainable fish to consumers. How would enacting the port state measures enhance our ability to combat IUU fishing above the bills before us today?
thank you, for the question, Mr. Blum. If that's adopted on an international scale, then, for example, countries like Russia, China, and Korea, where a large amount of king crab, IUU king crab, is being landed and then processed, this could be very helpful in terms of deterring IUU king crab fishing, which I just note at this point, at the level of IUU product that's king crab that's entering the United States, it's somewhere around $200 million worth of product a year that's coming into the U.S. and other countries.
That's king crab caught in the U.S. EEZ.
No, in the Russian EEZ.
So seafood traceability, do you see seafood traceability as a next step? And if so, why is it important to your industry? Is it the dollar amount? Is it the life of $200 million?
Thank you again, Mr. Sablon. Traceability, up in Alaska now, we are moving ahead with traceability programs for a lot of our fisheries, particularly the Bering Sea fisheries. And the Alaska Seafood Marketing Institute has taken the lead with Global Trust to implement a United Nations FAO-based responsible fishing code traceability system that results in labels being put on the boxes that have country of origin and the precise region where the seafood has been caught in this. So we see this as, you know, a key part of the international solution for ensuring deterrence of IUU fishing.
Okay, the gentleman's time is up. Chairman now recognizes Mr. Runyon for 5 minutes.
Thank the chairman. And first question is for Mr. Schwab. You justified that IUU fishing can estimated loss up to $23 billion worldwide. Just kind of on background, what are the primary species in the areas affected by it more than any other place? Or is it just?
It is a pervasive problem, sir, and it affects, I think, in some fashion, almost all fisheries and all regions of the world. I think it would be difficult to sit here today and characterize a particular fishery or a particular region of the world as particularly problematic.
Dealing with IU vessels, vessels not built in the U.S. and not flagged in the U.S. cannot be used for commercial fishing in U.S. waters, correct?
There are domestically operated fisheries are required domestic operation within U.S. fishing waters, with the exception of some of the insular.
So, but dealing with the seizure of vessels, we could not take them and flag them under a U.S. flag after seizure?
Generally, an IUU vessel that is seized domestically goes through some kind of a court proceeding after seizure. If a forfeiture takes place, our general approach is to ensure that the vessel does not is not permitted in some fashion through the disposition to re-enter illegal or overcapacity fisheries.
Because I think even talking about re-entering a fleet elsewhere, if you decide to sell it because you cannot keep it here, I know Dr. Graves testified that we're dealing with a global overcapitalization as we sit. So, and at the same light, as we hold on to them, and there were a couple other instances where, you're holding on to vessels through this process, and at the same light costing us, tens of thousands of dollars in maintaining vessels like that. Dealing with the seizure of it, what do we do with the fish that are on board?
They are generally, if they are of value, sold at auctions, and the proceeds are retained until final disposition of the case.
So they're sold in the U.S. market?
Yes.
And just one last question, kind of off the chain, and I think I ask you this question every time, dealing with Atlantic sturgeon. Do you have any plans in conducting a stock assessment anytime soon?
No, sir, not specific to Atlantic sturgeon. We still pursue whatever available information there might be to add to our understanding of the status of the stocks, but to my knowledge, there's no specific assessment planned.
Thank you. Chairman, I yield back.
Gentleman yields back. Gentlelady from Guam is now recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Schwab, enforcement happens to be a vital component to reducing IUU fishing in U.S. waters. In general, do you believe that H.R. 4100 would enhance your ongoing improvements to the NOAA enforcement program?
Absolutely, in many ways, some of which I've already mentioned. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Dr. Graves, you mentioned that recent years have seen an improvement for the stock of Eastern Atlantic bluefin tuna, due partly to increased monitoring control and surveillance measures enacted by the ICAT. How would the mechanism in H.R. 4100 build on this success?
Thank you. Actually, we're seeing an improvement in the control for bluefin tuna. There will be an assessment for the Atlantic bluefin tuna this fall, and so we'll actually see how much they're coming back or how much effort they're making. I think what you have in H.R. 4100 is a unilateral process, and where multilateral processes like ICAT or other RFMOs may not always get as far as we want, I think the unilateral process and forcing then bilateral discussions pushes things ahead. It gives us an advantage for getting our positions through in some of these multilateral fora. Mm-hmm.
I have another question for you, Dr. Graves. You also mentioned that despite these successes, RFMOs cannot be solely responsible for addressing the IUU fishing. But as Mr. Thompson's testimony highlights, IUU fishing is an international problem. So do you believe that efforts to coordinate national and international action, such as data sharing and assistance programs, can successfully bridge the gap between these two jurisdictions?
I think it will help. I think you have just an inherent problem in RFMOs because you have different parties with different agendas. And sometimes we, you know, have not gotten the conservation message that we'd like to get through the RFMO. And so having the opportunity to take unilateral actions, even though some of those may not hold up at WTO, has in the long run furthered conservation. Even though we might have lost a battle, we have won the war. And we've seen that happen with the tuna dolphin issue. We've seen it happen with turtle excluder devices, things like that. So I think you need both. I think we have to keep pushing unilaterally and then working multilaterally in the RFMOs.
And I have a final question, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Thompson, you mentioned in your written testimony the difficulty Russians has had in enforcing fishing regulations on the Russian crab grounds and the impacts on the U.S. economy. Now, do you support efforts by the U.S. to establish international assistance programs that provide expertise to other nations to help them address IUU fishing in their waters?
Ms. Bordaio, yes, we would support that. I mean, it's almost like, you know, there's a comprehensive package of things that need to occur, and we're aware that, for instance, World Wildlife Fund has been working with Russians, citizens and managers in the Far East, where a lot of this IUU fishing has occurred, to try to educate them on the importance of sustainable fishing practices, with similar to what NOAA has implemented around the coast of the United States.
Right. Further, Mr. Thompson, with the responsibility that the U.S. has in protecting the American fishing industry, how can enforcement measures such as permit sanctions and civil and criminal penalties benefit legal fisheries and discourage IUU fishing?
I think, again, Ms. Bordaio, it creates what's called a level playing field. The legal fishermen are subject to, you know, a lot of oversight by U.S. Coast Guard, National Marine Fisheries Service. And so in other countries, you know, to some extent, this is non-existent. So, yes, I think it would be very helpful.
Well, thank you, gentlemen. And, Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
Gentlelady yields her time back. Next up is Mr. Young.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Arnie, dumping of illegally harvested crab in the U.S. market, how did that affect your price?
Congressman Young, I appreciate that question, too, but it has a real dilatory effect. And recently, it was just a year ago, the supply of Russian crab was constricted a lot by enforcement in Russia, and there was a big upward jump in the just the price paid to the fishermen on the grounds. It went from something like $6 a pound up to almost $10 per pound for Bristol Bay king crab.
Okay, so it does affect the price. Mr. Schwab, Mr. Thompson notes that 2010, the illegal harvest of Russian crab totaled 2.6 crabs per every illegally caught crab. I thought we had a good relationship with Russia. That's 2.6 illegal crab to one. Now, how's that happen? Are you negotiating with Russia, what I'm saying? Are you stopping this illegal fishery and just letting it happen?
Yes, sir. There are active discussions between a number of countries and Russia over improved enforcement and documentation of the legal harvest of Russian crab. There are active discussions to address that situation.
Okay, but NOAA seized the illegal imports of Russian crab that have entered the United States. After the product was seized, what happened to that illegally caught crab?
I don't know specifically in that case. Generally, if the product has some value, it is auctioned, and again, if the proceeds are held pending disposition of the case. When there is a seizure, there is some ultimate sort of court proceeding.
I'm saying, if they seize it and NOAA auctions it, does it go back in the market? Is it legally caught?
I would have to check specifically in that case.
That's an analogy of having a cocaine bust, seizing illegal cocaine, and then selling the cocaine on the street. I mean, it don't make sense to me. I'm saying we're supposed to be doing this. So
I understand your question. Let me get some more detail on that. We'll get back to you,
sir. All right. Mr. Thompson, again, you noted that the amount of illegal Russian crab being harvested is almost the same amount as illegally harvested crab. What effect is this having on the sustainable of the Russian crab stock, and even does it affect your stock?
Mr. Young, again, the effects on our stocks, well, negligible because there is a separation in the Bering Sea between Eastern Bering Sea, Alaska, and the Western Bering Sea being Russian waters. But it definitely puts a lot of pressure on the Russian king crab stocks and other stocks that are because the king crab fishing, the IUU king crab fishing is so profitable. You know, there's a systematic bribery and corrupt system that, to their credit, the Russians are trying to clean it up. But when you have such a lucrative trade going on, it cannot help but put a tremendous amount of pressure for overfishing of the stocks.
Well, I according to news reports, the fishing vessel Bagen Perskene was seized and taken to Dutch harbor on October 2011. However, the fate of that vessel was not determined in 2012. As I understand it, the Coast Guard bought it to Dutch harbor and it was turned over to NOAA. Mr. Schwab, is that correct? And how long is that vessel going to sit there?
Yes, sir. As I mentioned a few moments ago, there is a seizure and then there is a court proceeding to determine the
sink
fate.
It.
I'm sorry?
Sink it. We save lots of money. No court proceeding, just sink it. Simple.
So, but in fact, we do take possession of the vessel. We do incur responsibilities for maintenance, moorage, and security
including
until there is a court decision.
Including crew, because the crew, my understanding, was still on there. And how much does that cost?
No, I believe that the crew are turned over to appropriate authorities. We don't take responsibilities for the crew. The Coast Guard incurred responsibilities in preparing the vessel to bring it safely into port.
Who paid for it, Mr.?
Ultimately, the cost of handling the vessel until it gets into port rests first with the Coast Guard, although we ultimately do pay some of those costs, and then the cost of handling the vessel in port until there's a final disposition, and then ultimately the final disposition are costs that NOAA incurs, and we certainly share your concern with the expense that's related in those cases. However, certainly in the number one, given sort of due process, we do have to incur those costs until a court mandates some final disposition. And then secondly, certainly in the scheme of the cost to our industry of illegal fishing, it is something that we feel like we have to do in the meantime.
I'm just asking you, I want to know what it's cost us for 1 year and how much money came out of NOAA, and how much money came out of the Coast Guard, and how much money it cost the taxpayer totally, the seized vessel.
So to date, we've expended a little over $300,000 for some of the expenses that I mentioned, moorage, maintenance, security.
Okay, give me the whole total and give it to the committee, because I'm trying to promote my sinkum.
So, yes, sir. So with the Coast Guard expenses, we're up over $500,000. By the time we're done, it easily could approach significantly more than that.
Okay. All right. The gentleman yields his time. Mr. Sutherland from Florida is now recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Schwab, thank you for being here today. I want to ask you a couple questions. The IUU is interesting to me, and I wanted to ask you just a few questions. A few moments ago, you said you didn't know the primary species that were affected when Mr. Runyon was asking you, or which ones were likely to enter the U.S. markets. My question to you is, then how can you attest, and I live on the Gulf of Mexico, how can you attest or quantify the impact that those fish could be or might not be having on a particular species of fish? If it's an unknown and you don't know what species, it seemed a little vague. And yet the information that is used to determine ACLs each and every year seems to be remarkably exact. I'm trying to figure out how do you use that vague data to come up with such specificity.
Thank you, Mr. Sutherland. What I said was that there are illegal, unreported and unregulated components of many fisheries around the globe, that to try to pinpoint one species or another or one geographic region or another as particularly more problematic is difficult as I sit here. There are certainly lots of examples, and there are more precise data points that sort of aggregate together to yield that estimate that's commonly referred to as, you know, 10 billion to 23 billion worldwide. I'd be happy to pull together some of the data behind that number and provide that to you, too. I think perhaps other members of the committee might be interested as well in a more complete.
Well, I guess what I'm most interested in is how do you factor in the effect of illegal or undocumented fishing. Like in the Gulf of Mexico, when determining, you know, ACL for red snapper?
While we're not certainly in the U.S., you know, immune to illegal activities, we do have a significantly, I think, better handle on what is happening within our domestic fisheries than what is happening with fisheries in other countries or in international waters that might lead to imports here. There are, having said that, generally conclusions reached, assumptions made, and estimates that are incorporated into stock assessments and fishery management plans to account for some level of illegal activity within domestic fishery management plans. And those really are developed on a place-by-place, stock-by-stock basis.
All right, I've been here just a year and a half. I've never heard that mentioned or ever allotted to as a factor in determining ACLs with any of the fisheries. So I would either encourage you to publicize that because it just seems so much easier just to blame overfishing on the recreational fishermen. That seems to be what seems to be the ace in the hole that is always thrown out on the table. I want to ask you, I am interested in the seizures of fish. You know, you said that the seizures, the fish are taken and then they're auctioned. Is that correct?
Generally, and I think this will be something that I'll have to provide some more detail to the committee on. Generally, if there is seized product that is viable, it is auctioned, and again, the proceeds are held because at the point of seizure, we can't be certain of the ultimate sort of disposition of the case. So while a product might be seized based upon certain allegations, a court proceeding would ultimately determine who's right or wrong in any given case.
Is there the particular product that is being sold, is that credited against someone's catch limit? Catch share?
Well, it would be accounted for within an overall, ultimately accounted for within an overall quota, and the way in which it would be allocated would depend upon the particular management framework that is in place.
Yes, but if you seize illegal product, and then you sell that illegal product in the open market. Okay, because we are told that y'all are very, very concerned about us catching any fish, like small numbers of fish, over the ACL. I guess my question is if you are taking seized fish and selling it, and the proceeds, I don't know what happens to the proceeds, but I guess it either A, has to be credited or taken away from someone's catch share or their quota, or A, you'll be a reason that you're driving the price of those fish down. I mean, is it that big of a problem, or is it that substantial amount of fish?
Well, I think in some cases, the Alaskan crab case that was cited, for example, here, it can be significant enough to affect markets. I don't know that for a fact, even in that case. Generally, it's not of that magnitude. But it is true that in some case, and it would again depend upon the management framework that is in place for that fishery, if it is an individual who has over-harvested a share of the quota, that individual would be held responsible for that overage. If it were part of a shared quota, then in some fashion that
I guess my point is this: is if you're counting it against a quota, that's a set number, and y'all have proven very able at being inflexible or to the private fisheries out there, then it has to be taken away from what the private fishermen enjoy if it's counted against the quota.
Well, this goes back to it would depend, really, sir, on the kind of management system.
Forget management for a second. But I mean, if you've got a quota, and you're not going to go over that, and right. You have seized fish and then you've sold them, and you take that away from the quota is established for hardworking men and women who are making a living utilizing the established quota. So in your scenario, are the hardworking men and women penalized because you're taking seized fish and selling them on an open market, counting against their quota? That's pretty simple.
So the quota is, the overage is accounted for in some fashion, either in that current year or in subsequent years. It would depend upon, again, if there were an individual quota assigned to individual fishermen and there was one fisherman who experienced an overage, then that individual would be held accountable. If you're dealing with an open fishery, then it depends upon ultimately how the fish are accounted for over the course of that season as to how that would play out for that fishery in subsequent years. I'd be happy to sort of develop and work through a few examples for you, but it's not, you know, it varies from fishery to fishery.
Yeah, the gentleman's time has expired. More than expired. I now recognize Mr. Sablon for further questions.
Yeah, thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I just have one more question and maybe a suggestion. But Mr. Schwab, you mentioned that there are currently some limited controls on the possession and sale of billfish in the United States Pacific waters. Can you please explain what those are?
Yes, sir. So some of the billfish restrictions actually originated from state level prohibitions that were ultimately incorporated into the highly migratory species plan in the region. And so I'm trying to find a few of my details on that to answer your question in more detail. But on the West Coast, commercial harvest of striped marlin has been prohibited by California, again, federalized when the HMS FMP was implemented and approved in 2004. And the sale of striped marlin by a vessel with a West Coast HMS permit was then prohibited. There is a similar marlin landing possession prohibition in Washington, not in Oregon. There are some very small numbers of billfish that have been reported landed in Oregon in some cases by non-HMS permit holders.
And on a less serious note, I tend to like Congressman Young Sinkin, but I think instead of sinking it, we should actually maybe select some of the boats, and those boats we can use, we could give it to the Coast Guard so they could patrol the region I come from, because we're getting ripped off big time with fishermen from other countries because the Coast Guard just does not have the capability or the resources to patrol this area. It's huge. It's the size of the continental United States. And like I said, I think they have one boat out of Guam and a kayak and a Zodiac from the, in the Northern Marianas. And we can't expect them to do their job well if we don't give them the resources. Nothing against the Coast Guard. I think they're an excellent partner. They want to do their work, but they don't have the resources. So we should be selective. Sink those we don't need. When, you know, we don't need to go to court. Just sink them. And then the rest, we'll use it where we can. Thank you.
Gentleman yields back. I have one additional question for Mr. Schrattweiser. Given that there is some issues with respect to the billfish that may affect commercial versus sport fishermen or vice versa, are you willing to work with members to kind of seek solutions, resolutions, so that we work all that out so both sides are properly taken care of and we deal with the billfish issue?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The intent of this bill is to stop importation. We're not here to penalize U.S. commercial anglers, so we would be willing to work towards an end result that would accomplish the goal.
Okay, very good. Thank you. Does any other member wish to ask further questions? Ms. Southern, would you like? You sure?
Positive.
The chairman recognizes the gentleman for 5 minutes.
I promise. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Schwab, I want to continue on our line of questions. I know you find this surprising. Do you know how many pounds of fish were seized last year?
I do not, offhand.
Is that something you could get for us?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Because I'm very interested in your comments that there is a quota that is established for hardworking men and women, and then when you seize fish, it's counted against that quota. Seems to me then they are penalized because of you seizing them and offering those on the open market. Is that a possibility? Is that done?
So, again, some seized product is auctioned.
Okay. And counted against quota?
It depends. So a lot of...
But you said just a few minutes ago in my first 8 minutes of my five-minute time, you said that they were.
What I tried to say, and is that for each management plan, there are different ways for accounting for overages. And while I don't know the ins and outs of every,
but let's just say the crab, because that seems to be, you know, an area that is not my expertise. But you know, if there's a poundage quota, and if illegal crab is seized and sold in the open market, will NOAA count that crab that was sold against the established quota?
No, that would not be, that would be.
Now, the gentleman to your left is nodding his head yes.
Well, he's we can not. Let him answer in a moment, but the answer that I would offer is that is from, that is not from the domestic market, it's not from the domestic stock, so that product would not be counted against the domestic management plan. Now, if somebody to my left has a different answer, I'd have
Well, maybe I misinterpreted his nod. Let me ask you this. Is there an example where there is domestic fish, domestic product that has been seized because it was caught illegally, it has been sold into the open market, into a domestic market that has an established quota, and that poundage counted against the quota or the quota, the amount of fish or product that has been established?
So it would be accounted for at the end of the year in some fashion in most cases. But I'm a bit out of my day-to-day expertise here in trying to provide you too many details in the way that that takes place from fishery to fishery. I'd be happy to follow up on that with you.
No, that would be great. I haven't got too many details, but that would be helpful. And I would like to know which particular catch share programs have been affected by the seizure. And let me just be clear, this is not an area that the IUU is not something that I'm very familiar with. So, you know, I would want you providing information for me will be for educational purposes. So I would appreciate you being able to do that.
Oh, happy to do that.
Thank you very much. I yield back. I've got I did good, Mr. Chairman.
The gentleman yields back a minute of the 3 minutes that he took too long, but we'll accept that. Unless there are any questions about sinking boats while the crew is still aboard, I think we're done for the day. I would like to thank the witnesses for their valuable testimony. Members of the subcommittee may have additional questions for the witnesses, and we ask you to respond to these in writing. If there is no further business, without objection, the subcommittee stands adjourned. Thank you.